I'm a Canadian born and trained physician. I grew up in Toronto, Canada. I always had a love for the outdoors, and going through my latter years of pre-med and then medical school, in the summer times I worked as a logger in sort of the mid parts of British Columbia. And I remember I would, you know, finish my final exams and get on a plane the next day and fly out to British Columbia and start work, and I'd basically work for the 3 months of the summer and come back and start university again. Training has taken me to Vancouver, it's taken me to Liverpool, England, it's taken me to Auckland, New Zealand. I spent a year running a mission hospital in Kenya, and also, you know, did some time working in Thailand as well. So I've had a chance to enjoy medicine in different parts of the world and see some very nice different environments. And Nora and I was chief of surgery at that time, and you know, you always showed a keen interest not only in being very good at what you do in the OR, but also always you know, chatting about your past experience, you know, being a well-trained Marine and a soldier, and all those experiences, along with your interest in seeking some evidence of the existence, you know, of the of Bigfoot or Sasquatch. Yeah, and hiking at night, you know, for people who haven't done it before, you know, it really is a wonderful experience. It's you know, of course, you don't have the visibility of everything that's around you, so, you know, you have to watch where you go and watch your step and try to be quiet. And but it's I think it's a really fun personal experience to go hiking at night. Because you hear your own breathing, and you're not as distracted with a lot of the sights and sounds around you, and I think it tunes up your senses. It was basically an uphill climb from where we started,
right.
And I don't know what our elevation gain was in those first 3 hours, but it was probably 1,500 or 2,000 feet.
Easily.
And so by about 3 o'clock in the morning, and I'd worked all day, so by about 3 o'clock in the morning, I just said, okay, I'm ready to lie down. And, and it was really windy, and it was starting to get cold, and this was sort of, I think it was the third week of September, and we just kind of made a little windscreen with some logs and just lay out the bags, and then I crashed for a few hours, and it felt a lot better in the morning. So we didn't really see a lot of tracks of a lot of backpackers or things like that. So it was really quite remote and very rugged. You know, we were right at the tree line, so the trees were really tiny and shrimpy, and a lot of scree coming down from the mountains, and so it was pretty rugged terrain. And we had a nice little mini campsite. You're right up at the tree line, so the trees, there's very little, you know, protection, you know, from the wind and things like that, and the wind was already starting to come in. But we did find a nice little campsite, one of the few little flat areas, you know, right in that spot, tucked in behind some shrubs, so it was a little bit out of the wind. And cooked up a nice dinner, and by about 6 o'clock, and the sun was just starting to peek down behind the mountains up there, it was really starting to get quite cold. And finally, later on that evening, you know, we got into our sleeping bags, and we didn't have any tents, so we were just, you know, sleeping out, and put like a ground sheet cover over top. And eventually, when I woke up in the morning, you know, and I had lots of layers on and trying to stay warm. And eventually, when I woke up in the morning, I think I was the first one up. But there was a layer of ice, pretty much over everything, right over the sleeping bags. And
it was a chilly night.
So it was a cool night. So anything that had moisture, you know, basically froze. And I had a little hanging bag, a water collection bag, and hanging from a branch. And that had probably about a, you know, quarter to half inch of ice, you know, on the top layer of it, which was kind of interesting to see that, you know. And here we are in September, and you feel like you're, you know,
wintertime.
So it took a little while to kind of warm up and cook up some breakfast, and we did that, and then packed up, and then we started our way down from there. So that was the high point of the elevation. As I said, a very rugged, remote, you know, kind of an area with the rock formations and the scree, basically all granite, you know, kind of formation.
A bit about that.
Yeah, it was a very unusual track, and it was kind of in soft, you know, soil, and it was pretty deep, so it seemed like, you know, something either was pretty heavy or something, you know, jumped, or but it wasn't a track that I was very familiar with. I mean, it was pretty small. I mean, I think we said maybe it was only 5 or 6 inches.
Right.
And it didn't look like any animal that I'd seen. It didn't look like a bear or a coyote or a deer, which would be the kind of the three big mammals that you'd potentially see up there.
Here's an example of a casting. This is from May of 2011, and I don't know if we can catch that on the image at all,
right? Yeah,
some of that, but you can get a sense that there's this is the ball of the foot here, the rest of it's pretty flat, and you know, you'd be hard pressed if you didn't have a flat foot to actually create this kind of an imprint. You know, if you had a real high arch in your foot, no matter how soft the material was that you were stepping in, you just wouldn't get this kind of appearance. So definitely the individual who created this is has a pretty flat foot. This angled imprint and the slightly wider toe. So they're obviously very, very similar. The angulation of the bottom and the length of the toes and things are very, very similar. This tract is from August of 2009, and this one is from April of 2011, and these were found in different parts of the Sierras.
Hello, little side camera.